we receive the body of our brother John with confidence in God, the giver of life, who raised the Lord Jesus from the dead. Grant, Lord, that we who are baptized into the death of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, may continually put to death our evil desires and be buried with him, that through the grave and gate of death, we may pass to our joyful resurrection through his merits, who died and was buried and rose again for us, your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, even though they die, yet shall they live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor powers nor things present nor things to come, nor height nor depth, nor anything else in all creation will be able to separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. We brought nothing into this world. We can take nothing out. The Lord gave, the Lord is taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. We meet in the name of Christ, who died and was raised by the glory of God the Father. Grace and mercy be with you all. I extend a very warm welcome to you all here for the service of thanksgiving for John Owens. Especially welcome those who are joining us online this afternoon. I'm very, very pleased to have with us here this afternoon the Bishop of Clogher and the Archbishop of Dublin, who was a former Bishop of Clogher here. You're very welcome to join in our service, and we are grateful for your attendance. May I at the outset say my deepest and heartfelt sympathy to Margaret, to Helen, David, the family circle, and assure you of our thoughts and prayers, both now and the days ahead. At the end of the service, could I ask the congregation to follow the remains down to the Cathedral Hall and go into the Cathedral Hall, because it's a private burial. It'll only be a short space of time, and the family will come back and greet you, but in the meantime, you can have your tea in the Cathedral Hall. We have come here today to remember before God our dear brother John, to give thanks for his life, to leave him in the keeping of God as Creator, Redeemer, and Judge, to commit his body to be buried, and to comfort one another in our grief, in that hope that is ours through the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Therefore, we pray that here today we may know the peace of Christ in communion with all God's faithful servants. God of all consolation, whose Son Jesus Christ was moved to tears at the grave of Lazarus, his friend, look with compassion on us, your children, our loss. Give to our troubled hearts the light of hope, and strengthen us the gift of faith in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
as children of a loving Heavenly Father, let us seek the forgiveness of God, for he is full of gentleness and compassion. Call to remembrance, O Lord, your compassion and your loving kindness, for they have been from of old. Lord, have mercy. Remember not my sins nor my transgressions, but according to your mercy, think on me. Christ, have mercy. O keep my life and deliver me. Put me not to shame, for I have put my trust in you. Lord, have mercy. May God our Father forgive us our sins and bring us to eternal joy of his kingdom, where dust and ashes have no dominion. Amen. Let us pray. Merciful Father, hear our prayers and comfort us. Renew our trust in your Son, whom you raised from the dead. Strengthen our faith that all who have died in the love of Christ will share in his resurrection, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
A reading from 2 Timothy chapter 4, beginning at verse 6. And the time of my departure has come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith. From now on, there is reserved for not only to me, but also to all who have longed for his appearing. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. We remain seated and we'll say Psalm 23 in alternate verses. The Lord is my shepherd, therefore can I lack nothing. He shall convert my soul and bring me forth in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Thou shalt prepare a table before me against them that trouble me. Thou hast anointed my head with oil, and my cup shall be full. Glory be to the Father, to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit.
A reading from St. John, chapter 14, beginning at verse 1. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, there you may be also. And you know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we do not know where you are going. How can we know the way? Jesus said to him, I am the way, and the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. Peace I leave with you. My peace I give to you. I do not give to you as the world gives. Do not let your hearts be troubled, and do not let them be afraid. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Anything that I say today will only but scrape the surface of a much loved, highly respected, trusted, and true friend of all who knew him, and a true friend of this cathedral for over 62 years. The turnout today, and especially that of the choir, shows the esteem that John has been held in. I do thank the choir for taking time off school or off work to be present at this service today. John William Humphries Owens was born in Londonderry on the 16th of December 1935. He was elder of two sons born to Nan and Jack Owens. His brother Norman was born 3 years later. In 1941, he went to the Model Public Elementary School in Derry. He was almost six, much older than the age which children start school today. And as there was no school buses, his mother took him by public transport. School dinners did not exist at that time, and he took a flask of Ovaltine and a sandwich for lunch. He did well at school. Primary school days were during World War II. He remembered having to take a gas mask to school, and in the interest of health, he was given cod liver oil once a week by his class teacher. As a child, he spent a lot of time outdoors playing with friends and camping, and made homemade tents during the summer. They all enjoyed playing cricket. At the age of eight, he started learning the piano. But like many children, he was not very keen on it. In his teens, he swapped the piano for organ lessons. In 1948, he began his secondary school education in Foyle College, which was at that time in the city centre. Foyle had his own entrance exam, and at the same time, a new qualifying examination was set by the then Minister of Education. In the same year, BBC Radio broadcast the first live programme of Top of the Form. John was chosen as the under 13 pupil. The question master was Richard Dimbleby. Foyle won the competition, and a few weeks later, the secretary handed John a letter. And it was from a girl in Luton who had heard the broadcast and wanted him to be her pen friend. He told her that he collected stamps and coins, and not long after that, a parcel arrived with dozens of stamps and coins. The girl's father was a museum curator. John set the usual school exams, junior and senior certificates, and A-levels. He was only 17 at the time, and he was advised to stay on another year before going to Queen's in Belfast. While there, he lived with an aunt and uncle. He took an honours degree in English language and literature with Anglo-Saxon and French. As John wanted to teach, he stayed on at Queen's for another year to do a diploma in education, taking a great interest in the education of children with special educational needs. And on the advice of his professor, he went on to do a Bachelor of Education. His dissertation impressed the professor so much that he offered to arrange for him to go to work at the Institute of Learning in Geneva. John declined the offer as he wanted to be an educational psychologist here. Before he could do that, he had to teach for 2 years. He applied for his first job as head of English in Limavady Grammar School and was duly appointed. He stayed there for 3 years, and there he met a pupil, Margaret Atchison, who was later to become his wife of 55 years. In 1962, a job was advertised as an educational psychologist in Fermanagh. John applied and was appointed. He told his mother he would stay for 6 months and then go to Belfast. Such was his love of Fermanagh that he was still here after 62 years. He joined the cathedral choir and he sang in it for 56 years. Although he still continued to be a member of the choir and had a great interest in it during his illness, but a throat cancer stopped him singing. He joined the Five Mile Town Choral Society and was instrumental in the formation of the Fermanagh Choral Society. When Margaret went to Queen's, she met up again, and on the 25th of July 1968, they were married. For their honeymoon, they put camping equipment in the car and travelled through Europe and ended up in Venice. Quite an adventure in 1968. This was the start of many years of travelling. One of his great interests was music, particularly organ music. His favourite composer was Johann Sebastian Bach. Such was the liking of Bach's music that when the Berlin Wall came down in 1989, and travellers were allowed into East Germany, he and Margaret headed to East Germany to visit everywhere Bach had been and to go to every church in which he had played. John was in his element. He heard that a church in Derry had an organ that was being given away because a new organ had been donated to the church. He immediately got in touch with the rector and made arrangements to go and to buy the organ. It was duly installed in the house and could be frequently heard sometimes as the house vibrated with full volume. The family were made complete by the arrival of Helen and David, who brought much joy to their lives. And the family was even more complete when their three children, Anna, Sebastian, and Katharina, summer holidays were spent camping in Ireland and abroad. Initially in a tent, but later in a luxury camper van. With the reorganisation of the education in Northern Ireland in 1972, John was appointed Principal Educational Psychologist for the Western Education and Library Board, a position he held until he retired on the 31st of December 1999. He didn't fancy working in another millennium, and during this time he developed the school psychological service and the provision of education for those in greatest need. Throughout his life, John was an avid reader and particularly interested in medieval literature and architecture. He was never happier than when visiting ancient ruins of castles, priories, and abbeys. At home, the family will remember him for making devices of all kinds. Retirement gave John and Margaret more time to travel in their camper van and headed to Europe 3 times a year, each trip lasting 6 weeks. And I remember when I came here, they always made arrangements to be back for the harvest. In fact, when I did come here, I was told about the Owenses by the then Bishop of Clogher, now Archbishop of Dublin. Not that he warned me of the Owenses, but it told me all about the Owenses being great traditional parishioners of the cathedral. The Owenses travelled extensively from Denmark to southern Spain and from western France to Croatia, but France always seemed the favourite. They took by roads and ended up in remote villages. As Margaret spoke French and John attempted to speak French, they were able to converse with all and sundry. John just loved to chat, and we all know that. And I know more than that, than this last week in the hospital. There was days he was in overdrive, but he just loved to chat. In recent years, life changed due to a diagnosis of prostate cancer in 2012 and throat cancer in 2018. He was treated with the utmost care and attention in whatever hospital he found himself. And I think it'd be very remiss of me today to not say a special thank you to the staff of Ward 8 in the South West Hospital for their, not only their care, but for their love and care of John since he went in there on Boxing Day. And too, may I say a sincere thank you to the family, because I know you never left his side. You were always with him day and night over this past number of days. He had an interesting and productive life, and he left his mark wherever he went. And he will be fondly remembered, not least by his wife Margaret, daughter Helen, son David, daughter-in-law Louise, his three grandchildren, Anna, Sebastian, and Katharina, and also by his brother Norman and the wider family circle. And he will certainly be remembered in St. Macartin's Cathedral and remembered with St. Macartin's Cathedral Choir. How do we mix glory and grief in the one instance? Well, we've just done that. Last Wednesday afternoon, it was a very special time when John's nearest and dearest were all around his bedside. In that time, John was still very much conscious and in his usual full flow. John was fully aware of what was going on and where he was heading. He was pleased to take part in that final service of commendation from our prayer book. It was indeed a privilege to spend time praying with him and the family, committing him into God's eternal care. He took part in all of the service, and at the very end, clearly recited the Nunc Dimittis, "Lord, now lettest thou thy servant depart in peace." And he was the departing servant. There was absolutely no doubt that John could have said those words, those well-known words recorded in our first reading that Sebastian read here today. "The time of my departure is come. I have fought the good fight. I have finished the race. I have kept the faith that we all know of a truly committed, faithful, and devout traditional prayer book Anglican. So much so that any Thursday morning when he was here, we have a Thursday morning service, and Willie Holmes, the projectionist, always asked me, are we doing service one or service two? I'd say, just wait a few moments to see if John comes through the door. And as sure as John came through the door, the one finger went up to Willie. It was service one that we'd done. John had a wonderful impression on people, not least myself. John passed away very peacefully and entered into his eternal rest on the Feast of the Epiphany. The season of Epiphany in the church's calendar is all about the revelation of Jesus. And the stories we hear during this season, the baptism of Jesus, the miracle of the water to wine, the wise men bringing priceless gifts to the baby Jesus, emphasize the glory of God in the coming of Jesus into the world. And that same Jesus has now called John into the next world. Christians have responded to the revelation of God's glory by affirming Jesus as the divine Son of God. The season finds its climax in the transfiguration of Jesus on the mountaintop alongside other biblical greats in Moses and Elijah. And here we witness a foretaste of the coming glory of Easter, the epitome of God's shining glory in the blazing light of Jesus' holy presence. It may seem incongruous to talk about the glory of God on a day when we grieve the death of one dearly loved among us. It may at first seem pure nonsense to focus on the brilliance the beauty and the blazing light of God's presence in and around us during the darkest, coldest part of the year, as does winter time and the autumn of life and the winter of life. In death comes to all of us, but after winter, spring appears, and the spring of eternal life is the glory of God, glory in grief. I do not hesitate in this funeral sermon by mentioning God's glory in Jesus, and not only because we still find ourselves in the season of Epiphany, it's more because of whom we remember this day. Because for me, John's life with us, even to the very end, truly reflected God's glory, in the sense that his presence conveyed dignity, respect, elegance. All who knew John knew how often he upheld the values of proper equity, especially in church. Epiphany is faith's response to the dark, cold days of winter. Epiphany is faith's response to the dark, difficult, painful times of our life. Not that we deny, brush over it, or try to hide reality. Despite the loss and amidst the grief, the small nugget of hope of the beauty of the glory of God. John was never shy in especially pointing out, gifted at pointing out different things, recognizing and affirming that hope, the brightness, that glory of God in us, even when we could not see it in ourselves. He truly had the gift of encouragement, and he used it. Through the course of life, through the course of his life, in exercising his gifts of encouragement, hospitality, generosity, and care, he was being transformed into the likeness of Christ's glory, a journey towards God. The Christian life, from baptism to death, is indeed a journey of being changed, transformed into the likeness of Christ. And periodically on this journey, in good times and even through difficult times, we pause to give thanks, to celebrate the good, the blessing, the gift that there is, whether we see it or not. At this funeral service, we give thanks for the life of John, who now celebrates at the banquet feast of heaven and sees for himself the true glory of God. May our lives, as did the one whom we remember today, reflect the glory of God. May John rest in peace and rise in glory. And now to God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be all praise, honor, and glory this day and forevermore. Amen.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Please be seated. Just before I begin the intercessions this afternoon, I wish to say a few words and offer some remarks today. It's a great privilege to join with you in the family of the Cathedral Parish to give thanks this afternoon and to celebrate the life of John Owens. And I simply add my sympathies and my thoughts to those extended by the Dean, to John's wife Margaret, and to the family circle, as we surround them by our prayers this afternoon. We've already heard much about John's amazing life and his devotion to his family, his many gifts of learning, his professionalism, and of his love of music. There is so much to celebrate in just one life. And as your bishop, and on behalf of the diocese, I especially wish to emphasize and to record our thanks to Almighty God for the gift of John to the choir of this cathedral. Anglican cathedrals have at the center of their life and worship the wonderful asset of choral music. It's what marks us out, and it's part of our particular way of expressing Christian worship. Today we thank God for the outstanding faithfulness and dedication of John to the life of this choir for 60 years or so. Faithful service week by week in support of the ministry of St. Macartin's, and faithful commitment to countless diocesan events held here over the years. It's a unique record of service, and as the Dean said, a wonderful tribute that the choir are here in such numbers today, and especially the number of young people whom John and Margaret have inspired by their friendship, goodness, and their love. That record of service reflects the wonderful tradition of Anglican worship which John held dear. And in our hearts and minds this afternoon, we hand him back to the one who created his love of music. I know that being members of the Diocese of Clogher meant much to both John and Margaret. And in Margaret's case, she is a key member of our diocesan safeguarding support team. And we have highly valued both of them in the offering of their time and talents to the work of God in this diocese. I have known John and Margaret just a short time since becoming bishop, but I am very pleased today to be joined by Archbishop Michael, who I know is a friend of long standing, and who, as a former Bishop of Clogher, can also testify to the amazing contribution of John to the life of this diocese. And so, on behalf of the diocese, I offer the family our sincere love and prayers on this difficult day. And as they and we bring to God thanksgiving for a life of joy and faithful calling, may they know the blessing of God himself in their own lives, as John himself responded to that call in his unique, inimitable way. May we bow our heads in prayer. God of mercy and Lord of life, you have made us in your own image to reflect your truth and light. We give you thanks for the life of John Owens, for the grace and mercy he received from you, for all that was good and true in his life, and for the memories we treasure today. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O God, your mighty power brings good out of evil, joy out of grief, and life out of death. Look in mercy upon all who mourn, especially this family circle. We pray for Margaret, for Helen and Peter, David and Louise, and the grandchildren, Anna, Sebastian, and Katharina. We ask, O God, that you would look in mercy upon them and give them patient faith in times of darkness and strengthen them with the knowledge of your love. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
You are tender towards your children, and your mercy is over all your works. Heal our memories of hurt and failure. Give us the wisdom and grace to use aright the time that is left to us here on earth, to turn to Christ and to follow in his steps in the way that leads to everlasting life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Merciful Father, entrusting into your hands all that you have made and rejoicing in our communion with your faithful people, we make our prayers through Jesus Christ, our Saviour. Amen. And we conclude our prayers saying together, Heavenly Father, in your Son, Jesus Christ, you have given us a true faith and a sure hope. Strengthen this faith and hope in us all our days, that we may live as those who believe in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to eternal life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
I should like to thank Margaret and all members of the Owens family, and also the Dean of this Cathedral and the Bishop for having me here among you, that is, among old and long-standing friends in Enniskillen and in the Diocese of Clogher. My experience of and my friendship with John, I suppose, began through the fact that my mother was a schoolteacher, and she would have spoken to us at home of a visit from an extremely interesting, intelligent, and compassionate man, Mr. Owens, who would have come to help her in relation to a whole host of questions and issues, problems and concerns involving children whose needs, I suppose, we understand now with greater sophistication. But a number of years ago, were a little bit of a fog, and there was always hope, there was always care, there was always concern, but there was nothing like the sophistication of ignorance, sophistication of knowledge in those days. It was something more akin, I think, to an anxiety about how to do best. But I would say that my mother was always uplifted by the encouragement that John Owens gave her. because he was somebody who built up rather than tore down. He was somebody who gave rather than took. And in a way, he was somebody through whom Jesus Christ lived in the everyday things of the world and of his work. And it was for me a wonderful thing when I returned to the Diocese of Clogher to be the bishop, to connect afresh with John and with Margaret here in this cathedral. Stalwarts, positive inevitabilities in the life of the cathedral, always contributing, always bringing other people on, always giving of their best to the glory of God and to the enjoyment of others. And I did indeed, Mr. Dean, not warn you, but apprise you of the Owens and the wonderful contribution they always made and would continue to make. And I think your address pointed very much in that direction. We stand interestingly, and sadly, of course, on a day like this, between the Epiphany and the Resurrection. And it would be my intention to use the prayer, the collect for the Epiphany, along with the prayer for resurrection, which we have in the funeral service. But so predictable our clergy, I have to speak of three things before I do that. But I take them from the words of the Dean in his address. One is that of continuity, and that astonishing and wonderful way in which John not only straddled two millennia, but at the same time contributed over more than half a century. And that, I think, ought to make us sit up straight and to remember the greatness, the goodness, and the glory, and the simplicity at the same time of the man. The second is that of transformation, because everywhere he went and in everything he did, he found something new, something fresh, and it always was woven into a marvelous tale, because he could tell a very good story and weave you right into the movement of it. And the third is something which has worked its way through the totality of our gathering this afternoon, that is thanksgiving. Because it's not simply a question of happiness, it's not simply a question of joy, it is a question of giving thanks. Each of us in our own hearts, for what we remember, what we experienced, what we continue to carry of the spirit of the man, and also thanksgiving to Almighty God for giving him such vibrancy and vitality, as I say, across more than half a century and over two millennia. So we thank God for John, and we thank John for everything that he gave us of himself, and we all carry that active and positive memory with us in that spirit of thanksgiving, of transformation, and of continuity. So let us pray. The collect for the feast of the Epiphany. O God, who by the leading of a star didst manifest thy only begotten Son to the Gentiles, mercifully grant that we, who know thee now by faith, may after this life have the fruition of thy glorious Godhead. Through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who is the resurrection and the life of all who believe in him, and who, by his apostle St. Paul, has taught us not to grieve as people without hope for those who sleep in him, raise us from the death of sin to the life of righteousness, that when we depart this life, we may rest in him, as our hope is this our brother John doth, and that at the resurrection on the last day, we may be found acceptable to you and receive the kingdom prepared for all who love and fear you. Grant this, merciful Father, through Jesus Christ, our mediator and redeemer. Amen.
Keep silence for a moment.
John, Granddad, inspired me in so many ways, from how he enjoyed his 88 years of life to how he treated other people. He loved his family and friends and was kind to those that he did not know. I could not imagine a truer gentleman. For a man terrified of heights, he walked halfway across the Karakareed rope bridge to rescue a young girl in need. This was long before there was any safety net. He was at home when carrying an interesting conversation or entertaining a crowd with his unforgettable sense of humor. I and many others had the privilege of hearing his stories, of which he had so many to tell. I will remember him as a happy camper, an entertainer, and a family man, someone that was interested in people, music, and exploring the world around him. He was fascinating, and his life was full. I am so grateful for all the precious time that I enjoyed with such a wonderful man. I will always cherish the memories that I have of John William Humphries Owens, Granddad.
God, our Creator and Redeemer, by your power, Christ conquered death and entered into glory. Confident of his victory and claiming his promises, we now leave your servant John in your gracious keeping. In the name of Jesus, our Lord, who died and is alive and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.